Welcome, everyone. Good evening. Thank you guys for joining us tonight for another fabulous public lecture. I am Jessica Flack. I'm a professor at the Santa Fe Institute, and it's my pleasure to host our two speakers tonight, Tim Jenison and Farley Ziegler. But before we get started, a few words in memory of Sam Shepard, who passed away this past Thursday. Sam was, of course, a wonderful playwright, short story writer, director, and actor. We at SFI were fortunate to have Sam in residence for a time as a Miller Scholar. You can read a tribute to Sam by SFI President David Cracker on the SFI website. He was an unforgettable person and a brilliant commentator on the complexity of life's relationships. We shall miss him. SFI's 2017 Community Lecture Series is generously supported by the Thornburg Investment Management, with additional critical support from the Lensic. Also, special thanks to SFI Chairman of the Board of Trustees, Michael Mobison, with whom the idea for this public lecture was originally conceived. Our next community lecture is by Jeffrey West, the professor up at SFI. Jeffrey will be talking about his book, Scale, which has received absolutely excellent reviews. It's a great book. And that will be August 29th at the regular time of 7:30 here at the Lensic. So please join us for that. Okay, so tonight we have a special event. We are screening the wonderful documentary film, Tim's Vermeer. The film was nominated for a BAFTA and shortlisted for an Academy Award, and it was made by Farley and the comedians and magicians Penn and Teller. And I'm very much looking forward to seeing it again tonight. I've seen it many times. What we're going to do is jump right into the film, and then after the film, Tim, Farley, and I are going to have a discussion. And then there'll be an audience Q&A. Well, an absolutely fabulous film. I think this is my seventh viewing, and I'm still enjoying it. And
it took me about eight to really get tired of it.
And let me say, I mean, I think in a way it's very Borgesian, as in the author Jorge Luis Borges. If you think about it, it's a detective story, and in which you're trying to reconstruct whether Vermeer used mirrors to paint the music lesson by precisely reconstructing to scale a room in which the music lesson takes place, and then painting it yourself using mirrors in such a way that the painting and the scene become a single continuous image. I love that. So before we get started and delve into the issues, I just want to introduce Tim and Farley, of course. So Tim, you heard about in the film. Tim's an inventor and a technology entrepreneur. He's considered a visionary force behind the desktop video revolution. He was into personal computers, and he saw their potential to integrate his many passions, so electronics, video, film, and music. And, of course, you heard tonight in the film that he's just a tad bit obsessive, too. So, Farley, you know, nothing wrong with that, of course. We love that. So, Farley's a producer, and the Wall Street Journal called Farley's film Troublemakers, the story of land art, among the great art documentaries of the past half century. And Tim's Vermeer is the latest in a long string of Ziegler award-winning productions, including Penn's hit comedy The Aristocrats, which I saw and absolutely loved. I'm sure many of you saw that too. And a collaboration with Peabody award-winning monologist Joe Frank to produce the NPR podcast In the Dark. So it's a pleasure to have Tim and Farley here tonight. And I think to start, it would be nice to sort of talk a bit about some of the themes in the film, some of the science ideas in the film that weren't fully explored. There's so much there. So will you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, you know, we thought that the film was going to be about Vermeer and about optics, but it took on a life of its own once they started editing, and it became a more of a human story, much to my embarrassment. But it, as a result, the science part got, you know, kind of glossed over a bit. And in the test screenings, the audiences just sort of, like, it went right over their head what was going on technically, and there was very clever writing that's deceptively clever that sort of explains what's going on. But people that were more interested in what was really happening optically, there was not enough information to sort of replicate the experiment. I've written more about it since then, and I continue to work on this and write about it. But if you're interested, the lens had a 710-millimeter focal length. The concave mirror had a negative 12-inch focal length, and the comparator mirror is a front surface mirror. All of these things could have been available in Vermeer's time, were available in Vermeer's time. There's been, you know, some scientific objection to the optics. Well, they just weren't that good, that wasn't available. That concave mirror, well, that was Newton that invented that much later. Well, no. The lenses were extremely good in Vermeer's time. There's some three lenses in the Royal Society in London made by Constantine Huygens in Vermeer's time that are telescope lenses. They have no idea why they're so good. They are polished to a perfect figure. The glass itself is quite bad. It's got bubbles and dirt in it, but the optical qualities are fantastic. The concave mirror, since it's in the focal plane, its properties do not matter one bit. In fact, you can put rippled shower glass back there, and it will reflect that real image perfectly. And so that's not a factor. And then the front surface mirrors were quite common. They were just as common as back surface mirrors. And metallic mirrors were quite common. So none of these things are beyond the ken of Vermeer's time. Another common technical question about the film is, what about the changing light? Since your comparator mirror is copying that tone exactly, what if the light changes? And there is some variation, but the short answer is that this ancient machine, has automatic brightness control and automatic white balance correction. And it happens because the canvas is lit by the same sky as the room. So I would be painting, and we have these puffy little clouds, as they do in Delft, that go across the sky. And if they go over the sun, the color temperature goes up. It gets bluer. And you can see that happening, and the room darkens, and it gets blue. But so does the canvas. And as I'm painting, it just doesn't make any difference. So I can still match the colors. Now, that's when I say within reason, sometimes, you know, the light does change. And some things end up getting painted too dark or too light. Some days a storm would arise and I would just have to stop painting. In general, though, human perception doesn't know about variations like that. We are very forgiving of an image. We don't care. So those are some of the objections. Another one is, in the film, we talked about human perception. We had Colin Blakemore talking about the center surround and brightness constancy and color constancy and so forth. Artists always object to this. They say, "I don't know about you, Tim, but I can see fine." And all you have to do is squint, Tim, and you can see the proper tones. And all these things are somewhat true, but if you've studied human perception, it's really remarkable how different it is than what you'd think. We think of the eyeballs as little high-def cameras, but that's not what's happening. What's being sent down the optic nerve is just the variations from one spot to the other. It's a differentiation of the image. And then that is integrated by the visual cortex, and the result of that is our brain somehow makes sense of that image, but we see illumination much more evenly. We perceive illumination much more evenly. And that absolute value, there, in engineering terms, there's no DC component in our vision. It's all AC coupled. And so, you know, it's not to say you can't see in paint. It's to say that Vermeer seemed to nail those white walls especially. And you're sitting in a room, those white walls, they look very evenly lit, and they're not. You know, they go almost from white paint to black paint. Vermeer painted in that way. Some other Dutch artists did too, and some Italian artists, and a Spanish artist. And so we're continuing to work on those angles.
Farley, did you have something?
Oh, I was just going to say, probably you have a sense of this from the end of the film, but the project didn't stop.
Yep, the obsession continued.
So actually, I have a question. So if Vermeer did in fact use optics to paint, do you think he anticipated the light qualities his paintings would have from the optics? Do you think that his move to optics reflected an attempt to make visible or bring to the fore qualities that the light has but which we can only grasp unaided? Did he have this sense?
Well, it's hard to put ourselves in Vermeer's shoes, which were wooden. There's nothing written by Vermeer. So it's all circumstantial evidence. But we do know that Dutch art at that time was trying to achieve realism. It was kind of the Holy Grail. If you build it, they will come. They thought that if it would be like looking through a window if they did their job exactly right, and they literally said that. And, you know, people that wrote about art theory at the time, there wasn't that much written. It was all, you know, sort of guild trade secret stuff. But Samuel Hoogstraten wrote about it, and he suggested that people use camera obscuras. He said, you know, use the camera obscura, it's fantastic. You know, there was no evidence of a stigma about using optics. So my guess is that Vermeer was just trying to achieve that goal of absolute realism. He found a tool to do it. And it was not an expedient. It slows you down. Vermeer painted 40 pictures in 20 years, that's all. Whereas Rembrandt, at the same time, in the same country, turned out well over 1,000. And so it was not a good business model. And Vermeer Vermeer sort of went broke at the end. Mm-hmm. But one of his paintings, they say, sold for 600 guilders, which was about the half the price of a house in Delft. So quite expensive. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I imagine Vermeer, you know, in my, you know, we all build a metal model. And since there's nothing known about Vermeer, he's sort of the Rorschach test of art theorists and art historians. Everybody projects, you know, themselves, me included, on Vermeer. But I just see him striving for this perfection. And, you know, it's almost an insult for modern art theorists to say that he wasn't, that would have been cheating or whatever. You know, no, I believe he's just trying to achieve a perfect result.
I was just going to say that one of the things that's come up on occasion is sometimes we think of, or at least I have formerly, sometimes thought of, like, you know, ye olde times, and the people way back when just weren't as smart and advanced as we are now. But when I have the fortunate kind of role of bearing witness in the filmmaking to Tim's experiments, and he's, you know, except for the cinema cameras recording the experiments, he's armed with 17th century equipment. The mic stands in lieu of a wooden stand, but everything else, the hand ground lens and the handmade polished silver mirror, and working out problems and issues of lighting. And there's, it's just him alone in a room with kind of low-tech, high-tech optics. And there's nothing that, I don't know, there's just nothing, the bridge isn't big between...
We were the same species 300 years ago, basically. Yeah. And optics then was sort of the high tech, and Delft was sort of the Silicon Valley. There were four, you know, I think at least four lens makers in Delft. The telescope was a brand new invention, 50 years old, immediately disseminated everywhere. And these lenses that Vermeer must have used, from the focal length and the diameter, they would have been very typical telescope lenses, the objective, the far end of the telescope. So in the case of music lesson, that was 710 millimeters. The lens I'm working with right now is 1500 millimeters. You know, typical telescope lenses.
Okay, so what I want to do now is broaden the discussion a little bit. So I'd ask everyone to bear with me for a few minutes while I put on the table some material we can use to back out a bit. And actually, it's material that connects to Santa Fe, New Mexico. So it's also interesting for that reason, into complexity science. So In The Recognitions, which is a novel by the American author William Gaddis, the protagonist makes a Faustian pact with an art dealer to forge 15th and 16th century paintings by Dutch and Flemish masters. Now, you will know if you've read this book that it's hard to sum up. If you've made it through the whole book, I'm impressed. I'm on my third try, halfway through each time. As William Gaddis of the introduction, it's a book that you read over the course of your life.
It's a rip-snorter, a page-turner.
A page-turner, it is. Yeah. But it's a deep book. And so instead of trying to sum up the book myself, I'm going to let Gaddis do it, and I'm going to do it with a letter he wrote in 1955 to Robert Oppenheimer in response to an address that Oppenheimer delivered to Columbia University in 1954 called There Are No Prophets in Science. And what Gaddis in that letter did is he sort of summed up his view of The Recognitions and his motivations for writing it. In a blurry mixture, and this concept of blurriness is going to become important later in this discussion, of his own and Oppenheimer's words. And I'm going to read you a part of that letter. So he writes, Gaddis writes, "The Recognitions is about, quoting Oppenheimer, the massive character of the disillusion and corruption of authority in belief, in ritual, and in temporal order," stop quote, "about our histories and traditions," again quoting Oppenheimer, "both bonds and barriers among us, and our art which brings us together and sets us apart. And if I may go on presuming to use your words, it is a novel in which I tried my prolonged best to show," quoting Oppenheimer again, "the integrity of the intimate, the detailed, the true art, the integrity of craftsmanship and preservation of the familiar, of the humorous and the beautiful, standing in massive contrast to the vastness of life, the greatness of the globe, the otherness of people, the otherness of ways, and the all-encompassing dark," end quote. The book is a novel about forgery. "I know that if you get into it, you will find boring passages, offensive incidents, and some pretty painful sophomorics. All of these in my attempt to present the evils of superficiality," again quoting Oppenheimer, "and the terrors of fatigue. As I have seen them, I tried to present the shadowy struggle of man surrounded by those who have dissolved in a universal confusion and those who know nothing and love nothing." So both Gaddis and Oppenheimer were concerned with integrity and authenticity, where the origins of greatness lie and what makes for a genuine contribution. And finally, how we can push human potential beyond its current limits. Now, these same questions, I would say, that consume them consume us now, right? So in sports, with its concern about doping and human augmentation, in science and journalism, with the current obsession with credibility, and very much, of course, in politics, right? And so it seems to me to also be a major theme, implicit theme, in this film. And, of course, in the Hockney-Falco thesis, both in terms of asking what an artist's use of tools and technology, what that means for how we understand and appreciate the works that they produce. In Tim's case, so obviously that's, you know, a big debate around Vermeer, and, of course, in your case, Tim, what value is there in being able to reproduce a painting and reconstruct the possible process used to create it, right? So in some sense, if we back out a bit, this is a debate about the relationship between process and outcome, right? So my questions for you both are, if the outcome is beautiful, does the process matter? If the process is good and has integrity, should we worry about the outcome? Does it matter if we fail? And finally, does knowledge of the process influence how we perceive the quality of the outcome?
You know, Hockney's book came out in, I think, 2001, mm-hmm. A Secret Knowledge, where he looked at late Renaissance art and he said, you know, something changed, something profound changed, and at the same time, optics profoundly changed, which is true. Lenses evolve very quickly. Eyeglasses go back to like the 1300s, but they were made very crudely. They were made by blowing a bubble of glass, breaking it into pieces, and then flattening one side. So you had a curved surface, but it was not good enough to make a telescope, for example. Just before Vermeer's time, what made the telescope possible was grinding the spherical side of the lens, mm-hmm. which the Germans discovered. Anyway, so Hockney, you know, caught holy hell for pointing this out. And he didn't really deserve it. I mean, yes, he deserved it. I mean, he was being kind of a jerk about it. He printed a T-shirt that said, "I know I'm right." And he went to a big get together of art historians, and there was this big symposium in New York, put on by Ren Weschler, and art historians showed up, Hockney showed up, and they were all discussing this. And Philip Stedman was there, and his wife, and Ruth Stedman said, "I've never seen professionals behave so badly." The people were very upset about it. And I think it gets down to this integrity question. Mm-hmm. You know, we expect our artists to be better than that sort of thing, but this is, and therefore the cheating question, you know, is it cheating? And as I said before, I think they were using the tools available. You know, we use special effects in movies today, and maybe that's a better analogy to a painter trying to make a picture then. Mm-hmm. You don't need to know how they make, you know, space aliens or toys come to life. You don't really care. You just want to sit there and be entertained by it. And nobody complains that you used CGI to make Toy Story, that it should have been hand-drawn or something. So, you know, but it is sort of a modern, as we said in the film, it's sort of a modern notion that you shouldn't use technology to make art. You know, as Philip Stedman pointed out, perspective is a technology. Mm-hmm. So anyway, I think it's a different kind of integrity. I think Vermeer's integrity was to the image. His devotion was mm-hmm. to the image, and at the expense of anything. And it looks like several Dutch artists may have known of this technique, and therefore they must have kept it secret. And so the question was, did they keep it secret because they were ashamed, or it was unethical, or it was cheating, or was there some other reason?
Well, and does being ashamed mean that it's cheating? I mean, right, there's a perception out there. They have to deal with that perception.
Yeah, it's guilt, you know, of violating something. But, you know, there are no rules in art like there are in football. You know, that's part of what sports is.
What was
obeying the rules.
And what was the my quote of Penn Jillette quoting Andy Warhol is art is anything you can get away with?
And he got away with a lot, Andy Warhol.
Yeah, he should have tried that instead.
Yeah, and you know, people have been pushing the definition of art to the point of, you know, it doesn't mean anything anymore. Anyway, I don't know if that addressed your question at all, but I look at it as, you know, to me, Vermeer gets better, not worse, because of his technology. He was inventing, and he was, you know, it looks like other people knew it. And now, why would it still be secret? There's an economic edge against your other painters, your competitors. That's a possibility. There were the guilds, the trade unions. The Guild of St. Luke specifically is what it was. They had trade secrets, like the Freemasons would not teach laymen how to lay out the first course of bricks mm-hmm. in a wall. That was a secret. They had these contracts between the apprentice and the master painter. And the contracts would spell out, you must reveal all the trade secrets to the apprentice for this money that we're giving you, mm-hmm. which implies that there were a lot. And maybe it just wasn't all that remarkable. Nobody really questioned how an artist worked, really, at that time. People didn't speculate, write about it. There was no internet. There were no newspapers. Most people were illiterate. Would the subject of one of these paintings, like, complain, hey, he used some sort of lens on me? Maybe. Maybe that should have come out.
I think you hit on it.
I was just going to... Oh, no, go ahead.
Well, I mean, you hit on it in a sense when you said that maybe Vermeer's commitment to the image is actually a source of his integrity. I think that's a very interesting idea. Farley.
No, I was just going to add to what Tim had just said, which is we met with one of your fellows, Chris, I think, today, who talked about how the history of technology, even as we speak, gets lost. I mean, people
aren't... Lost technologies, yeah.
They're not making records mm-hmm. of how we did this.
Mm-hmm. The closest thing I found to a written record of this comparator process was 200 years before Vermeer. Leonardo da Vinci, who basically invented everything, he wrote a book on painting and he described something quite similar to it. He said, the mirror should be the master of the painter. You should look at your subject reflected in a mirror and compare it to your canvas. He didn't say, carefully compare the color at the edge of the mirror. And he went on to talk about, you know, how the mirror sort of removes the context and so on, which may mean he was talking about something else. He did later talk about the matching concept, though. He said, if there's a distant mountain and you don't know exactly what color it is, you can hold up a card with some of your paint on it and be careful that the paper is lit, but you know, by the sun. And you know, so he had the concepts there. Mm-hmm. And there's no evidence that Leonardo painted that way. In fact, he went out of his way to diss the people that relied on technical tricks in their painting. He said, you just got to learn anatomy, you know. There's no shortcut. But Vermeer, Leonardo was published, and, you know, you can imagine somebody 100 years later reading this, maybe Caravaggio, who was around Milan at the time, maybe reading Leonardo's description and going, well, let me try that. And in researching this, I found just countless examples of literature linking mirrors to artists, but not that. So that's the best argument against this hypothesis.
Will you just mention a few of the artists that you've also been investigating?
Yeah, so other people that may have known the trick. Caravaggio, whose name was Michelangelo Merisi di Caravaggio. Caravaggio was the city he was from. He sprung on the scene with a totally different style, what they call chiaroscuro, and this is before Vermeer's time in Italy, and he, you know, he set art on its ear, and most people hated it. We know a lot more about Caravaggio than we know about Vermeer. We know that generally he wouldn't let people watch him paint. He painted his friends only. He owned a lot of mirrors. Mm-hmm. He was a crazy man. He was a murderer. He was probably a pimp. He probably murdered a fellow pimp, a rival gang member in Rome. He was banished from Rome. He moved to Malta, where he killed a knight of Malta, and, you know, just a nut. And when he would get in trouble, he would say, hey, I'm Caravaggio. And his patron would get him out of jail somehow. But one of the clues, well, it's very photographic. The Caravaggio's, the shading on the faces, you know, the faces just look like they're there. So the simplest way to use this comparator process, mm-hmm, is to just have a three-dimensional object. No lenses or anything, just a mirror. So I could paint you if I had the easel here and the mirror here. Now, you would have to be this close. You would have to be the same distance as the canvas to, mm-hmm, the mirror. Otherwise, when I move my head, everything shifts. But if you're the same distance, there's no parallax, so I can use this trick of moving my head left and right as I paint. It also means that your face is going to be exactly life-size on the canvas. Mm-hmm. If you use that trick. And guess what? The Caravaggios are life-size. And you don't know this if you're reading an art book, or even if you're in a museum, it's hard to tell, but if you measure it, you know, I looked at a lot of Caravaggios and, you know, measured this distance and compared to statistical charts, and they're all, you know, like within 10% of life-size. Another painter with the same characteristic is Diego Velázquez in Spain, who painted all these pictures of the court of Philip IV, very photoreal portraits and all life-size. Then you move up to some other Dutch painters. There was a lot of them around the city of Haarlem who painted these still lifes called breakfast pictures. And some of the breakfast pictures were highly realistic, but life-size. Some of them were not life-size and not very realistic. There seems to be an association there. So I suspect they knew it. And there was one Harlem painter named Torrentius, who painted made two different kinds of art. Mm-hmm. He made these extremely realistic still lifes, and then he made these sketches of people, mostly pornographic sketches of people. And people, you know, they said, why are these two kinds of art so different? And he said, well, when I make these still lifes, it's not me that paints. I put the canvas on the floor. I hear the sound of buzzing bees, and the painting paints itself. So they imprisoned him and tortured him. He would not admit to, you know, making a pact with the devil to the end. They destroyed all of his art. So it's just speculation, you know, what was he up to? A lot of people speculated that he may have discovered chemical photography because people also described these strange smells. Mm-hmm. Anyway, one of his paintings was discovered in a grocery store in Amsterdam, near Amsterdam, about 100 years ago. And it's the only one that exists, and it's now hanging in the Rijksmuseum. It is very realistic. It's it's a pewter vessel and an earthenware vessel, and there's one of his pornographic pencil sketches that's been discovered. Anyway, so he was tortured basically, partially at least, because he had this magical ability to make these pictures and didn't have a, you know, prosaic explanation for it. That might be another reason to kind of shut up about your optics.
Okay, I'm going to come back.
I was going to bring that up to point out that Vermeer might not have been the only one.
Mm-hmm. Probably not.
Sounds like that.
I do believe, though, that Vermeer, he's the only one that seems to have used this triple element machine.
It's a very interesting invention. Let's come back to that in a second. So, and turn for just a moment to this, more explicitly to this issue of creativity. So in a review of the film that was published in The Guardian in 2014, the art critic Jonathan Jones wrote, "The technology Jenison relies on can replicate art, but it does so synthetically with no understanding of art's inner life. The Vermeer it spits out is a stillborn simulacrum." Jones goes on, "So what does it lack? The film implies anyone can make a beautiful work of art with the right application of science. There is no need for mystical ideas like genius." Well, when I read this, I had a good laugh. And the reason I had a good laugh is because not only could I not parse what an understanding of art's inner life might be, the quote also suggests that Jones has zero idea how good science is produced. He seems to think the scientific process is bereft of creativity. To sort of build on this a little bit, or to illustrate how it's absolutely not. In 1952, the information theorist Claude Shannon gave a wonderful lecture at Bell Labs on creative thinking. And in that lecture, he identified several ingredients for creative thinking and genius in science. He listed training and experience, of course, intelligence or native skill, motivation or drive, curiosity, what he called constructive dissatisfaction, meaning things could be better, how can I make things better? And, of course, taking pleasure in producing something elegant or beautiful or challenging, or in solving a problem and seeing the results. And we saw that, of course, in your film with your own painting. And Shannon then went on to enumerate a number of tricks or methods that can help one find creative solutions. And it's a very interesting lecture. I recommend everyone have a read. Now, if we agree with Shannon that creative thinking originates in these things, and it seems to me that he's making a very compelling argument, then the difference between art and science, that space is not so vast. And this kind of creative thinking, it seems to me, describes Vermeer, whether he used optics or not. So if that's the case, what is the real issue?
Exactly. I would agree with all of the above. But, you know, it's an argument, I suppose. But Thomas Edison once said, to invent, you need an imagination and a pile of junk. And to me, it's the human being the tool maker in one way, and the problem solver. And there are elegant solutions no matter what, if it's a painting or a piece of code. You know, I write a lot of code, and there's definitely great artistic works of art in software, you know, designing an algorithm. Your layman doesn't tend to look at it that way. They think of programming or maybe scientific endeavors as, you just do the math and the result comes out or something. But that's not how it works. I mean, there's a lot of science that's really boring and, no fun. But the germ of the idea...
How do you say Santa Fe Institute, by the way?
Well, it's possible even at Santa Fe Institute that some things are not fun. I'm not sure. But there's no difference. But, I'm speaking as a technologist, so I probably missed the point. And that's what Jonathan was saying, that Tim's Vermeer missed the point because the intangibles of art. He did say that he has no problem with the science. He said, yeah, Vermeer probably did that.
I was just going to say it's so refreshing to hear your what offended you most in that piece. No, it's really.
Well, it was one of our few bad reviews.
Yeah, I read a lot of excellent reviews.
Yeah.
Okay.
But what a guy.
So if it's not, creative thinking per se that sets art and science apart, could it be that we demand that creativity is expressed within the accepted constraints of a genre, a medium, a scientific method, the history of the discipline? So Tim, you said in the film that Vermeer may have been both an artist and a tinkerer and an engineer. And so in that sense, he was blurring lines, and this maybe makes people fundamentally uncomfortable. With the idea that he used optics, is he breaking down the boundaries of a problem? And that's what people are reacting badly to. They don't have clear distinctions any longer.
Well, if that boundary is there, I think it's a modern invention. They were very serious about their perspective, for example, and all the tricks of the trade. The perspective in the Vermeers, perspective, they say, was basically invented by Brunelleschi, trying to draw the baptistry at the Duomo in Florence, where it's an octagonal building outside the Duomo. And he was trying to construct it, and he realized that these vanishing points happened with these 45-degree walls. And it led him to this theory of perspective and projecting a three-dimensional set of points onto a two-dimensional surface. But the artists in Vermeer's time didn't generally know about that. It was much simpler craft. So it was one-point perspective. If there was a building like this, they would draw the horizontal lines, the vertical lines, and then they would have a vanishing point and go with all the orthogonals. Vermeer, those vanishing points are there, and sometimes they're, one of the vanishing points I calculated was 8 meters to the right of the canvas, but it aligns perfectly. And the vanishing point that you get by tracing those lines out off 8 meters off the canvas are exactly what you get when you calculate the angles of the objects that are in the painting. Mm-hmm. Specifically, this is in view of Delft, a picture of his hometown. And there are these medieval military gates. And they're almost coming right at you, but they're at a slight angle. I had to go to some 19th century maps that were actually surveyed with instruments to know what the angle of the building was. Once you know the heading of the center of the painting, and you know the heading of the building, you take that angle, subtract it from the heading of the painting, you take the tangent, and you multiply by the focal length, and you get the position of the vanishing point. So I did that for all the objects I could find in view of Delft, and everything worked. So either Vermeer calculated all those points and surveyed all those buildings, or he used optics. It's the simplest explanation. It's not likely that he achieved that without some sort of instruments. Mm-hmm. The picture, in fact, I'm living in Holland right now trying to remake View of Delft.
That's the landscape Tim looks at in the Moritz house, yeah, with that beautiful blue sky and the puffy clouds. It's the one big...
Yeah, some people have called it the most beautiful painting in the world. And it's very unlike... cityscapes were quite common in the Golden Age. And there were a lot of pictures painted of Delft, his hometown, and nothing is like Vermeer. There were readily identifiable landmarks in Delft, the Oude Kerk, the old church, the Nieuwe Kerk, the new church, and the Armamentarium, which is a military building. Those three things are still there, and of course they haven't moved. Mm-hmm. And the first thing I did when I got my building built on the viewpoint of the painting was I set up the lens and projected it on a print of the Vermeer and lined it up, and the old church is perfectly in the right spot, the right size, the right shape. Over here, the new church appears exactly at the right position, the right shape. The armamentarium is right there at the right height. And there's two sort of peasant women in the Vermeer picture that are standing on the sidewalk on the bank of the kolk, the pond. And in the projection, modern Dutch people are walking along right through them like ghosts, and they're the right size, and I mean, everything just matches perfectly.
Mm-hmm. Well, I say, because you figured out in advance the focal length of the lens that Tim would need to grind, he figured out, and the vantage point of the painting.
Yeah, it's very easy to figure out the vantage point because the painting is so accurate.
So again, we're talking about innovations and borrowing and technology and this blurring of boundaries. So Farley, a question for you. The issue of blurring boundaries, in my view, comes up in two of your other films, in The Troublemakers, which brings together architecture, landscape, sculpture, technology, archaeology, and photography, and also in some ways in The Aristocrats, which is exploring boundaries between the acceptable and the unacceptable. And I don't know, I mean, is this breaking of boundaries always disruptive, or are there examples of innovations that are readily adopted? And what distinguishes the innovations we're willing to accept from the ones we're not?
I love that question. I can't really yet have to give it some thought with The Aristocrats, which has 100 comedians in it all telling the same vile, vulgar, and obscene and disgusting joke, so it's not for everybody, but it is very fun. But the other question is, you know, it's funny to me, Troublemakers looks at these pieces of land art that's in a lot of it in New Mexico, and it's these artists labored for decades doing something of epic scale, regardless of how it kind of came out. But Tim's Vermeer, I don't see. I mean, it's kind of an epic, over decades. But the blurring of boundaries thing is that these are, I hear this word kind of used too frequently these days, process-based, but it's these works, like what everything that Tim is doing, and essentially these, giant, these earthworks here, there's an aspect of the process to me is the art, and what results is also art, but it's the making of them, which is the statement. I just think that the, not that that's, from my perspective, Tim's not, didn't set out to make a statement by his experiment, but everything you need to know is, you can see in the process. So I guess that's my...
Well, I mean, if Tim's Vermeer is crossing some line, it's like seven people care. I think I know their names. It doesn't amount to a hill of beans. It's not a cure for cancer. It's not a way to make a warp drive. It's arguing about what some guy did 350 years ago. So I think the reason for the emotion around this thing may be a little more mundane than that, and in that a lot of people have created a body of literature about their favorite artist, and it's not what I'm writing about that artist.
Well, it's not that mundane, because think about doping and human augmentation in the sports discussion. I mean, that is a heated debate for all of us, and I rarely hear anyone who has a sort of like totally clean opinion about it, right? We're not sure how we feel about doping and augmentation. It ruins some things, and yet it seems also a natural progression to, enhance human performance in that way. So I think the same kind of question is coming up in this Vermeer discussion.
Yeah, well, in the case of doping, I mean, that's a case, it's a sport with rules. And, you know, I guess there's an argument that you shouldn't ever put anything artificial in your body that enhances or distorts it. That's a different question. But in art...
I mean, are there implicit rules, right, for painting?
Apparently.
Are there genre-determined rules?
But we don't know Vermeer's attitude. And we don't know, by the way, what he was trying to say with these paintings. Some painters, we do know what they were trying to say in Vermeer's time. There was iconography, there was narrative in some of the paintings. They were like, oh, don't drink, it's bad because then your whole house ends up drunk and everything's on the floor. I mean, that was a common theme. And then there was, you know, paintings where, you know, Vermeer painted one with iconography. And there were books, there was a book especially that spelled out everything in a painting and what it means. So this big rock represents the church. A snake represents Satan. And so you have this Vermeer where there's a rock on top of a snake. And then this lady has got her foot on the globe, and she represents Holland ruling the world. And, you know, it's pretty clear. But these other paintings of just women, you know, reading a letter, who knows? And maybe Vermeer, you know, had a very clear idea. Maybe the people around Vermeer in Delft at the time would have known. But, you know, that's ancient history. It's generations away. We don't, you know, it doesn't magically get put across to us the way a play by Shakespeare would. Music is kind of that way, too. You know, unless it's an opera, we don't really know what the composer was trying to tell us.
Well, I guess another way of putting the question is, you know, there are some things that, because of our perceptual systems, are not easy to see. But with tools and technology and new techniques, we can better reveal them. And so to what extent is that kind of innovation acceptable because it shows us some beauty or amazing thing in nature that, you know, wasn't visible before?
Give me an example.
So, I mean, if you take the Vermeer, like you say, I mean, potentially with the optics that he used, he revealed properties of light and then our response to them that he probably, or maybe no painter was capable of revealing without the optics. Right?
I think it would have been a miracle to people looking at the picture. Just like a peasant farmer walking into a cathedral in Delft and hearing that pipe organ and seeing the stained glass windows. I think they're just, you know, and they didn't have television to stare at all day. And sometimes they'd actually put curtains over the paintings. And they would open the curtain to watch the painting. And then they would close it again. And that was their escape, if you will. You know, we use fiction and television and movies and games to escape. They had games, I guess, but they didn't have imagery to escape with other than paintings. So it must have been a pretty powerful thing. We just can't relate to that.
Have you ever looked at a live camera obscura projection?
Have I ever looked at what?
A live camera obscura projection?
Yes.
And I was thinking,
they wrote about that.
The mesmerizing quality of that is...
They wrote about it. And they, you know, they couldn't believe it.
Right.
You know, it'd be like watching a little DVD screen, except out of focus and really dim. But, you know, things were moving, and people wrote about the camera obscura image in Vermeer's time and before, and they just all said, oh, this is painting is dead by comparison. And if only we could capture that on a canvas. And it was that instinct, I think, instantly that people had to make a photograph.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the question here is, so there's this beautiful painting produced, and the question is what are the methods that can be used to produce it? And are some of those methods, for some reason, are we more comfortable with some of those methods than others?
Well, today, yes. I mean, Norman Rockwell was considered to be an illustrator, not an artist, you know, which is a big insult. He wrote about using technology. He said, yeah, I use the opaque projector. He called it the... Balopticon. It was the brand name for this thing made by Bausch & Lomb. He said, I use it, but I don't talk about it. But it saves so much time. And, you know, he made all these photographs. And then there were other people like Thomas Eakins, who you know, painted these bucolic pictures of people canoeing in the river and you know, looked somewhat photoreal. And he was also an avid photographer, but he denied that he would ever use photography in painting. Mm-hmm. I would never do that. And after he died, his wife denied it, but then they discovered his cache of photographs. And they are identical to the paintings.
Again, it's a reluctance to blur these boundaries. Okay, so what's next?
Why don't you talk about the Mona?
Well, yeah, after Tim's Vermeer came out, I was totally sick of painting. I still hate painting. It's not enjoyable to me in the least. Maybe if I was really painting, you know, by eyeballing, it might be enjoyable. I don't know. I took art in high school, and I liked it, and I, you know, can kind of sketch with a pencil. But I've never done it after high school. And so I was done with it. And I got an email from this guy in Tasmania named Jared Rollins. And he said, "My boss, David Walsh, would like to talk to you on the phone." So I Googled David Walsh. And he's this guy a little bit younger than me. He claims to be on the Asperger's spectrum. He's a very eccentric guy, a mathematical wizard, can do mental math. When he was in college, he was, you know, studying mathematics and visiting the casino across the street and playing blackjack, and found that he was quite good at it. And they discovered then, slightly later, that he was quite good at it, and he didn't allow him in the joint anymore. So he got interested in horse racing, and he started writing software to bet on the ponies. He describes it as basic Bayesian algorithms, but there are some interesting aspects to it. Anyway, he won $1 billion, with a B, and for his sins, he decided to build this art museum in Tasmania. He spent $250 million, I think. It's subterranean, it's massive, and they call it the anti-museum. There are no little white cards next to the art. In fact, there are no white anything. Everything's black. There are just little pools of light. They control your attention and your path through the museum with careful lighting. They simulate the entire thing with a game engine before they do an installation. And there's this little iPod thing that they give you. If you want to know about the art, you can sort of punch the button and it'll, you know, give you a paragraph about the art. You can listen to David Walsh say why he bought the art or why he's trying to sell the art. Or you can hear the artist talk about the art if available. And you can hear what they call the art wank, which is a curator who talks about the art. Anyway, it's a fantastic museum. And when I talked to him on the phone, he said, "Look, I saw your film, and I'm convinced, but you know, you're just one guy and one painting, and surely more needs to be done to further this along." So he said, "I'd like to do an installation slash performance art slash science. We'll hire painters, and we'll do anything you want. You know, you must have other experiments you'd like to do." So that opened about a year ago. It's still ongoing, and we've tried all sorts of new experiments, learned a lot. And as part of that, Farley said, "I'm going to film all this," and just sort of on speculation, and she thinks that it's going to be some sort of mini-series.
So Mona, it's called a Museum of Old and New Art, and it's stunning. And
the second largest art museum now, right, in the world?
Oh, you know what? I didn't know, but it transformed the economy of Tasmania, because it takes a long time to get to Tasmania, and so people are going and staying for a week. And I know that people stay in that museum, you know, they track all the metrics, and people stay like twice as long as...
Yeah, the average visit, I think, is 6 hours. And it doesn't hurt that there's a bar in one end.
Tim basically came up with several experiments that further his research. Mona hired 12 artists, actual real artists, I should say, to Tim.
What are you trying to say? No, they also hired some non-artists too.
More recently, now. For this, there's been it was so successful that they've extended it, and now they're doing another set of experiments with non-painters. Tim trained the painters on the optics, and they set sail on their own. The difference being Tim's warehouse is north-facing natural light, and this entire museum is subterranean. But the lighting, he worked out the light levels and everything.
Yeah, we simulated sunlight.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But anyway, so a raft of a Caravaggio and some other Dutch painters and many Vermeer portraits coming to a museum exhibit near you.
And that's how this Delft project arose, because we were going to have one of the painters do View of Hobart. Hobart is the big city in Tasmania. And it was just going to be this nice view across Berrydale Bay of some houses. And that didn't pan out because the place we were going to use to paint it from was no longer available. And so I was talking to David Walsh one day, and I said, you know, to really do this experiment more convincingly, you should do it in Delft, Holland, you know, where the light is the same and the weather's the same and, you know, the buildings are still there, some of them. And he said, well, yeah, let's do that. And I said, well, it's in a city park, you know, that's not going to happen. He said, have you asked him? And so one thing led to another. And the painter that they hired to do it, it wasn't available. And so I found these words coming out of my mouth. Well, maybe I should do it.
So Tim's living in Delft.
Yeah.
Did you want to wrap
up? Well, I want to actually open it up to the audience now for questions, unless you guys have anything else to add before we do.
That's great. Great idea.
Okay.
No questions.
Just one second. We're going to get the microphone so you can hear. Just a moment.
Oh, you know what? I just want to say thank you on behalf of Tim Jenison to the Santa Fe Institute. He was going to say it when he came out, but then we got swept into the conversation.
It's a fantastic trip and, you know, excellent logistics and accommodations, and it's beautiful. Beautiful place.
She has a question back there. Question. So, did you notice when you took the final painting back into the room that there had been a sort of spectral shift effect of the glass taking out some of the sort of longer wave reds and oranges as glass tends to do, and seeing that subtle shift in coloration of the room versus what you were seeing at the resulting end of the lenses?
The question was about the glass affecting the spectrum, and it does, but it's quite subtle. It, you know, it's hardly measurable compared to, you know, the kind of accuracy that a painter typically matches colors with. When you're using this comparative process, you're getting far closer to real colors than an artist ever attempts. You know, the artist may attempt it, but he's not going to be able to do it, he or she. And again, as I said before, artists just will not believe this. They think they're great at it. There was a paper published called, you could look it up, it's called Do Artists See Their Retinas? And they set up some machinery with some optical illusions, and they had three classes of people try to match colors in this sort of Adelson checkerboard illusion. And there were three groups, professional artists, art students, and non-painters, naive subjects. And everybody was meant to match these pictures with these illusions, these shadows and, you know, context problems. And the result was that all three groups performed equally, but the artists took far longer to get the wrong result. Anyway, I did have spectral issues, and on this view of Delft, my spectral problem is the lighting on the canvas. You have to light the canvas to use this comparison process, and it can't be coming from the lens, obviously. It has to be coming from a window or a light bulb, but that doesn't work because it's a constant, and they didn't have light bulbs. But if you used a candle or something like that, a constant source of light, then you have a huge problem with changing levels of light. But my problem with color temperature is when it gets clear, a clear blue sky. And, you know, the spectrum of that blue sky is quite strange. And I'm using, for my canvas light, I have some white cloth over the window that sort of integrates the entire hemisphere that's visible from that window. And if the blue sky dominates that, you get this sort of spectral peak there. I have looked at it a lot with spectrometers. In Delft, I have no instruments of any kind. But I noticed that I would paint white buildings yellow on those days. When I had a clear blue sky, I would paint the buildings yellow. That's exactly what happens. You get the complement of the color if the canvas color is wrong. You compensate that with your paint, and you make it white, even though it's not. So, yes.
Yeah, I wanted to follow on the experiments that you were doing lately. You took an enormously long time to do the Vermeer. Are the artists that you employ, do they have more productivity, or are they the same as the recent non-artists in being able to use this technique?
It's not that much different. Some of them are slower, or some of them are faster than me. They all struggle with it. They all seem to hate it. They rebel against it. They, if left to their own devices, they'll start out. When I'm standing there, they'll start matching colors, and then they just look away from the mirror and start painting. And the real takeaway from these experiments was that the artist's style just screams out when they're using this mirror. They are not obeying the mirror the way I obeyed it as a naive painter. So that's what these ongoing experiments are trying to do, is try to figure out what the, you know, what the training does. But they all, you know, one of the painters, Effie, said she finally came to peace with the mirror. And she painted beautiful, beautiful portraits. And, you know, but she can paint beautiful portraits anyway, but she does use reference photography to do it. So, you know, and some of the painters just said, well, I don't know what the difference is using this mirror or a photograph. It's the same thing. It's not really. What you end up with this comparator process is truer tone. To the extent that you really obey the mirror, you're getting, I guess you could call it a linear transfer function. You are directly translating the spectrum of that light to the spectrum of the light reflected off the paint. And photography doesn't really do that. Photography has a distortion in that curve for good reasons. And in chemical photography, it was an S-shaped transfer curve. You want to softly crush the whites and the blacks, because you get a better picture that way, but it's of no advantage to preserve the linearity. You could theoretically take a modern inkjet printer and a modern color, you know, digital camera and make a totally linear picture, but it doesn't look that good because, well, it's clipping the blacks and the whites. And in the case of Vermeer, the brooms that he painted, the dynamic range in that room, and I'm getting technical here, fit in the dynamic range of oil paint, which is the only way you can obey the mirror. But there were certain things that were too white to paint and too black to paint, and you actually see Vermeer clipping the blacks. They fall below a threshold, and whatever detail was there just disappears. And it's exactly what I painted when I was trying to do that. Oil paint, if you want to get technical, has a dynamic range of about between 5 and 6 stops. Every photographic stop is a doubling in the number of photons. So it's a range of zero, a ratio of 32 to 1, basically. And of course, the real scenes around us can be 10,000 to 1, easily. But in Vermeer's room, with diffused light coming from the window, all the objects that Vermeer painted in those pictures do fall into that six-stop range. Certain things have to clip, like right at the window, anything out there. And when I'm looking through the mirror, yeah, that's like three stops brighter than my white paint. So you do have to choose the center point carefully, what I call the DC level of the painting. That's done by lighting the canvas at a certain brightness. And I did it initially, in Tim's Vermeer, you can see my little instrument for doing that. I had a gray square tacked to the wall. And then on my painting, I had a tiny little gray square, exactly the same shade of gray. I would lay that on the canvas, I would look through the mirror, and I would open the shades of the window, lighting the canvas, until those two gray squares matched. And that would set my DC level for the entire painting. If that's wrong, the painting will be either lighter or darker. And conversely, if you had red light on the painting, you would have a cyan result. It's the complement. It has the exact opposite result. So if your canvas is too bright, the painting will be too dark.
I'm just going to say about the painters hired by Mona, all super smart, super talented, extremely dedicated, and very felt a sense of responsibility and honor to have been selected to do this project. But as Tim just said, they thought that they were, very often they thought that they were hewing very carefully to the optics, but not such as Tim did in this, as you saw in the movie. But there's a woman painting now who's one of the artists, and her background is as an architect. She's going to go on and become an architect. She's a painter, but not as much of a professional painter as the other painters in the group. And she, because of her training so far as an architect, had worked with Lightwave 3D animation software that Tim's company makes, and understood the optics of the entire project really deeply, and in fact helped to train the other painters. And she's now painting a Vermeer. They built a beautiful Vermeer room based on Tim's architectural blueprint and the lighting and everything. She's painting a Vermeer now called Young Lady Standing Out of Virginals, and she is hewing. She's so, in a way, she's got enough dispassion, or she's dispassionate enough as a painter and passionate enough about the project and understands the optics so fundamentally. I have hope that she's gonna, it's a wacky thing to say that she's almost as dedicated as Tim was to his experiment, to her own, to this experiment she's conducting, and it'll be very interesting to see.
One painter who happens to be an expert on Vermeer that they hired painted two versions of that room, one without using any optics and another with the comparator mirror, and he did not obey the mirror. He said, "I'm using it for spot checking."
Mm. And he's an example of somebody who was he's fundamentally look, Vermeer's works are glorious and gorgeous, and it offends him deeply, fundamentally, to think that Vermeer used a tool to achieve the look, though yep. This artist himself has spent a lifetime trying to paint like Vermeer.
Yeah, so he knew how to run the mirror, he knew what I was getting at, but he just couldn't bring himself to faithfully make a photographic picture.
And confirmation bias. He said, "Well, Vermeer never would have needed to do that, so I'm not going to do that."
I knew he had confirmation bias.
Okay, one more question.
From the balcony.
Oh.
From the balcony. Hi. First of all, congratulations on a fun, informative documentary.
Thanks.
The question I have is pretty mundane. Vermeer's early religious paintings, did you address those at all, and would you comment on those?
Yeah, they're Most pictures are what they call genre pictures, which are Dutch people living their Dutch bourgeois lives. There are at least three pictures that don't really fit, well, five pictures, I guess, that don't fit that mold. And the allegory of faith is the one I mentioned with all the iconographic content. It's a big picture. It looks like it could have been painted with the comparator process, seriously. Then there are these, most people consider them the first two Vermeers. They don't look like Vermeers at all. They look like Italian pictures. And there is no reason whatsoever to believe that Vermeer painted them. The other two pictures that are a little bit different than genre pictures are the scientist pictures. Vermeer painted the geographer and the astronomer. And there's this guy in a silk sort of kimono with all these instruments around him. And the speculation is that it's Antony van Leeuwenhoek, who was born the same month as Vermeer, two blocks away, lived two blocks away, had a lens-making lathe in his shop, made all these great microscopes, was the executor of Vermeer's estate when he died. Coincidence? I don't know. Anyway, the two Italianate pictures, one of them's religious. It's called Christ in the House of Martha and Mary. And the other one is a Greek mythology thing called Diana and Her Companions. They're very big pictures. The reason they attributed them to Vermeer is because it had Vermeer's name on it. There is no way to trace the ownership, the provenance of the picture back to Vermeer's time. They go back to the 1800s only. And the guy that authenticated them and attributed them to Vermeer was a crazy man named Abraham Bradius, who later in life attributed a whole bunch of new Vermeers in the 1920s and 30s. That turned out to be painted by this forger named Han van Meegeren. Same guy attributes those to Vermeer, although they're not questioned these days. There are two other Vermeers that are somewhat questioned as authentic. Anyway, Han van Meegeren got caught. You know, the Nazis occupied Holland. At the end of the war, they were going through Hermann Göring's art collection. They found this Vermeer, and it had an invoice from Han van Meegeren in Amsterdam, and he was one of the richest men in Amsterdam as an art dealer, because he kept discovering all these great Vermeers. And so they arrested him for treason, aiding the enemy, and which is punishable by death. And they put him in jail, and he said, "Look, I'm actually a hero, because that's a forgery that I sold to Hermann Göring." And they go, "Right." And he said, "Bring me some brushes and a canvas, and I'll show you." And they did, and it was all in the papers as a famous trial. And he painted this new Vermeer. And then they busted him for fraud. But the style that he painted in was in that Italian style, and he was sort of filling in the gap between the Italian Vermeers and the real Vermeers.
All right, well, let's thank Tim and Farley, and thank you all for coming.
Thank you.